I started playing with Star Citizen, and now I'm a space and sci-fi variety caster. If you're familiar with the Twitch scene, you probably know me. If not, then hi, hello, come to my channel.
I like the enthusiasm and the confidence. All right, so today we've decided, because every time I walk into Dave's office, he's playing Star Marine, we're going to play ourselves a little Star Marine today. Now, we're playing the 261 live environment today. 26 live environment. 261 is up on the PTU right now for a whole bunch of citizens. So if you haven't checked your email, you might have an invite to play on the public test server of the upcoming patch 261. So it's available to a whole lot of people at this point. Evocati, Wave 1, Wave 2, concierge members, subscribers. So check that out.
I got one too. Very excited.
Yeah. Did you get your invite today?
I got my invite, yeah.
All right, cool.
I'm downloading it now.
All right, so we are going to be playing Starmer here. We've already formed a group here, and we're going to jump into some Last Stand.
All right.
Some Last Stand. Baron, why don't you start us off? On every happy hour, we like to take questions from the Star Citizen community. So if you're watching on Twitch or YouTube, we do take questions from our Twitch broadcast. So if you want to participate in that, you can go to twitch.tv/StarCitizen and put your questions there. Be sure to preface your question with the word question in capital letters surrounded by brackets. That'll help Tyler and I pull it out from all the chat that goes on there. But Baron, why don't you start us off? I know you've got some questions. I saw you tweeting to your community. You were pulling questions for Dave Haddock, Master of Lore.
Yes.
Oh wow.
So let's do something good right off the bat. What you got?
Sure. Well, I personally, I'm not a big spoilers fan, so I don't want to dig too deep into story questions. I'm actually a little bit more curious about the writing process.
Okay.
Wow, this was a fast round.
Yeah. Good job, everybody.
Sure was.
Should I be
good hustle, guys?
Back to the
talk to you later.
Good hustle, guys.
By the way.
I'm sorry. What?
Should I switch the gameplay scene?
Yes. When you're playing, you should switch the gameplay scene.
Thanks, Red One.
You're not in charge of that. I'm not in charge of that.
Well, you got to tell me.
I got to tell you when we're playing the game.
Come on, Jared. So when you're creating a new planetary system, what is the process for, you know, developing the lore of that system? Obviously, you don't just, you know, pick a star random out of the sky and say, let's just make that one into a giant meat planet or whatever.
Right. Well, I wasn't going to talk about spoilers, and you just spoiled with the meat planet. Well, actually, with a lot of it was for the first, actually, like probably 2 years, a lot of it was very piecemeal, just because the team was even smaller than it is. I mean, right now there's four of us, and it was just sort of slowly chipping away at individual systems and getting flavors. It's like people would kind of come up with specific requests, and it actually wasn't until the star map started to become a reality that we kind of had to sit down and be like, oh, well, now we have to figure out the remaining, you know, 60 systems or whatever. So with that, I mean, basically we actually just would do almost nightly sync ups. It was Will, Adam, Sherry, and myself just kind of sitting and just brainstorming of, you know, all right, we have Callus system. What's exciting or interesting about that? And that was usually actually the first question that we always asked, like, what is the sort of specific character that system would have that would make it feel unique and fun and be a place that people would want to go to, and also could theoretically be a nice generation pot for narrative and story ideas. So we always kind of started with like what was sort of the flavor and character of the system or the specific planet, and then we would kind of dig into it from there. And I mean, sometimes actually we would get ideas from the news. In one of the, I think it was the Orion lore makers that just came out. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the gas giant Abyss, which is a coal black, you know, planet, which we had pulled from a National Geographic article. So basically, we'll, you know, because one of the things we learned very early on, because I know very little about science, is space is weird.
Yeah.
And odds are that, like, you can kind of say, like, oh, well, this doesn't exist. And then weirdly enough, like, a week later, we would see an article that was like, mm-hmm. oh, by the way, this exists. So it's very strange, and it's fascinating and cool. And so we would try to pull real stuff when possible, but ultimately, it always kind of came down to, you know, what was exciting or enticing about this place and would make it kind of a fun, unique environment to go visit.
engine. No.
It's that slight like sense of fantastic, I think, that will make things really stand out to people as well. Almost like a, not quite a fantasy environment. Like, it could exist, but it's enough to wow you at the same time. With some of the concept artwork I've seen based on the ideas you guys have come up with.
Oh, I mean, the concept stuff is just, it's, on a daily basis, is amazing to look at. And it's a two-way process, too. I mean, the art teams come up with such fantastic visuals, and it's like, oh, well, we have to figure out a way to make, to use that. Like, you know. So, yeah, it's definitely a multi-layered process.
So, how often, now, how many, we've shared a number of systems. I mean, when Star Citizen first was pitched, it had, was going to have, like, 40 systems?
I think it was actually 20.
20 systems. And, of course, through stretch goals, we've expanded that quite a bit. Yeah. Now, not all the systems are have been shared with the public, obviously. And I'm not going to ask you to share one that hasn't been shared. But I forgot where I was going with that question. Save me, Tyler. Where was I going?
What is your favorite color?
That's not where I was going. That's not where I was going.
Wow.
I don't know where you were going.
Okay, we'll just take a question from chat here. Right off the bat, will there be alien races that have yet to be discovered? I mean, we know about the Vandal, we know about the Banu, we know about the Xion. I mean, the Krathak.
There's them. I mean, it's a weirdly loaded question, because if you say, if the people know that there's an alien race out there but it hasn't been discovered, how do we know? Then you know that it's there to be discovered. So it's...
Gotcha.
It's
but you haven't ruled out the possibility.
No, I mean, it's the sort of thing of, like, you know, it's, we have allusions to sort of ancient civilizations. You know, there's the Hades system and stuff like that, which is sort of the decimated, you know, system that has, like, a planet cracked in half type thing. Mm-hmm. And the ruins on Kazi in Terra, you know. So there are allusions to sort of long-dead civilizations. So... Maybe, you know, it's one of those things that you gotta, we'll have to get you in there and see.
You know, I mean, technically, some of the wildlife we'll see on planets is alien. Was there going to be lore and history to some of the creatures that we come across?
You're getting some lag there, Jaren.
Yeah.
I mean, because that's sort of one of the fascinating things was the, because our terraforming process sort of wipes out the indigenous species that there's. It was sort of a kind of intentional thing, because it gives you a sort of blank slate, and you go, oh, you don't have to do 500 systems that all have their own unique biomes and, you know, physiology and animals and stuff like that. So, but we do have ones that are naturally occurring oxygen thing, which would have their own wildlife. So yeah, I'm hoping that soon we'll get to start doing some, you know, alien rodents.
I would like to point out that Bristol Boy, a former guest of Happy Hour, is on the opposing team. Uh-oh. In this match. I'm having some issues here.
All right. No more softballs. We're going to start asking the tough questions, like the pain that drives your character writing.
The pain?
No.
And before he gets to that, guys, people asking questions in Twitch chat, remember that Dave Haddock is the lead writer for Star Citizen Squadron 42. So if you're asking about gameplay design decisions and stuff, he's probably not the person.
So Chris has worked with quite a few of the big name actors before. There was probably some hope when creating Squadron 42 that some of those would be attached to this as well. Were there any characters that you wrote specifically for a certain actor?
Not that I can think of. I mean, there was sort of ones who fell in to place nicely. I can't think of any off the top of my head that were like, this, you know, this man or woman definitely has to be blah blah blah. You know, I don't believe so.
Now, while you were shooting Squadron, though, you were there to make adjustments based on the people who got the roles.
Yeah, we would do. We were sort of there to help out, and like if we needed polish and, you know, last minute changes and stuff like that we could implement them very quickly.
Do you guys do lots of storyboarding before you start writing, or do you tend to just sort of, you know, take a scene, see where we'll go first?
That's a good question.
Don't give him that. It's an okay question.
It's a good question. It's okay. Yeah, I mean, you know, there's particularly with Squadron 42, there was we would do very, very intensive, because again, it's like it's, you know, we have to sync up with design and we have to sync up with art, you know, and stuff like that. So we have to know, like, keep in mind, like, what the environment's going to be and what the game flow is supposed to be and all that stuff. So it was sort of by default, we definitely had a process like that, because we had to, you know, lock down the flow with design and in conversations with Chris and stuff like that. And it would just be easier to, you know, write it out as sort of story beats. You know, you go here, you do this, you talk to this person, they tell you this, drives you here, you do this, you know, like that type of stuff, rather than just giving a jumping right into a script page, because it would be entirely possible that you would be going down a wrong direction or something like that, and then you've wasted, you know, a couple of days working on a flow. I mean, sometimes, you know, you'll just write a scene just to be like, hey, you know, I think this might be cool, and you know, the one of the great things about the game itself is that you have these opportunities to hang out with the various characters a bit, so you get these, not everything is sort of plot driven, which, you know, as Chris has said in the past, like, is very different than movies, where you have to be very, you know, lean and mean, and you can have character moments, but usually they tend to be in aid of the plot, because you don't have a lot of time. Like, you know, a 90 page script, you don't have a lot of time to kind of mess around. Mm-hmm. And in this, like, you know, we had to go, like, well, what does the janitor do, and what do they care about, you know, type thing, because the player can go wandering away from, you know, we can be dangling the sort of beautiful story threads, and they can be like, hey, who's that guy, and go off and try and follow him, and we have to kind of accommodate that. So so it allowed having sort of these little unique character moments that I think, you know, is really going to make it be amazing.
I saw a question in chat. I'm curious if you're going to be willing to answer it. It said, without any spoilers and using only the chapter numbers, what is your favorite chapter in Squadron 42?
Nice work.
Because they don't know what the chapters are. They don't know what they correspond. Are you willing to go on record now so that when the game does come out, they can look at this and say, oh, this was the one that he said was his favorite? Are you willing to go on record with what your favorite chapter is? Is it chapter 4? What about chapter 5?
No. It's tough. It's really hard, because again, it's because there's just there's all of these sprawling moments that are sprinkled throughout the entire thing, that it's tough, because certain chapters will have scenes that I absolutely love and I like was thrilled to see get captured with and made even more amazing by the performances, but as far as like a start to finish, that's a really tough one.
I tried, man.
Yeah,
I tried.
Here's another one. Top Sock 66 says, how much influence do stories on it just fell off my screen. Who influences you? We'll just change the question because it just went away.
Who influences me personally or as far as the game?
Yeah, goes? Just when working with lore, like what type of things influence you, whether it's Star Wars or anything like that?
It's sort of all over the map. I mean, I was always a Star Wars guy, but I read a lot of fantasy. I love film noir, you know, so it's kind of the beautiful thing about this in general is there's the capacity to have so many different genres and be able to pull in so many different influences and stuff like that. So, you know, like the Kid Crimson short stories were very, very heavily influenced on like the Dashiell Hammett, you know, Continental Op short stories and stuff like that. And, you know, normally you wouldn't get to cite a 1940s mystery writer as a sci-fi influence, but wow.
Have you watched any of The Expanse?
I've watched the first two episodes of it. I got to be honest, I found Thomas Jane's fedora a little tough to get past. But I read the first two books.
So trendy. Okay.
It's good. The books were a lot of fun. And I have the third. They're up to like six now.
Yeah.
It's like I gotta.
Yeah. I think they said they were contracted out to like nine.
Yeah. So yeah, I got to get back to it. But I hear the show's really been picking up steam. Have you watched all of it?
No, I'm catching up right now to start season two. My roommate's watching it without me right now, so I'm trying to catch up.
You know what was also fun was Killjoys. I don't know if you watched that one. It was also a Sci-Fi Channel So
give me a second, guys. I had a crash.
No worries.
So
let's see what else we got in chat. Baron, you have any other? No. Oh, go ahead, Jared.
Obviously, we get a lot of questions.
Wait, sorry, Jared. Did you didn't rage quit?
That no, I won.
Okay, rage just quit. Making sure. Just
you didn't win. I was 5 kills ahead of you.
My team won.
It seemed like
yeah, you were carried.
And I did better than Tyler. That's, okay. That's you know really the only metric.
If
I
Dave
use in
is
life.
Going to talk some smack, I'd like to see what he's got to bring to the table.
Oh no, that would just be destructive.
Oh, maybe we can convince Dave to take control here.
I'm gonna but put
now.
You in the hot seat.
I'm gonna play another. Okay. I'm gonna ask you about 3.0, David.
Oh god.
I'm gonna ask you about 3.0.
Okay.
So. What is your involvement in 3.0? What are the kind of things that a lead writer contributes to 3.0?
Well, I mean, collectively, we are hitting on several things at the moment. The main ones are sort of have been the mission givers, which we've talked a lot about, sort of mission systems and stuff like that. But the people who give you the jobs, which is a surprisingly broad, huge conversation, because it's just a lot of, you know, it's a, as we discovered with the PU stuff, like, you know, Crusader alone is a pretty massive area of space. So how do you make that feel populated and stuff like that? So we do, we've been doing a lot of stuff with mission givers and also actually with the starting to flesh out the locations, because to sort of, as far as like environmental storytelling and set decorating and stuff like that. So like how do we sell the personality of Hurston, you know, on Lorville and stuff like that, and as opposed to Orison on Crusader and stuff like that, like, you know, because those are two almost diametrically opposed places. You know, Hurston is really just depressing and awful and rigid and almost dystopian, and then Orison is this super like, hey, look at the pretty clouds outside and sky docks, yeah, you know. So as far as they're like, what kind of signs would they have? What is the sort of tone and stuff like that? So we've been talking a lot with like the environment teams and trying to work out and the designers and stuff like that to try and work out like how do we sell those things.
Tyler, are you getting the invite?
Yes, got it now. Okay. Chat loves this topic, by the way.
So mission givers. Now we saw the only mission giver that, you know, the 3.0 style mission giver that we've seen so far is our good friend
Miles.
I'm sorry, Miles Eckhart.
Yeah.
I was going to call him. I couldn't remember the.
Take your time. Phil?
Phil. I was going to call him Phil Miller.
Right.
I was going to call him Phil Miller.
Yes. The immortal Phil Miller.
Yeah. The immortal Phil Miller. So Miles Eckhart. Now we've seen him give an off the books kind of mission. Kind of a rogue style mission. Are those the only kind of missions you can get from that kind of?
No, I mean he was actually an interesting. He was sort of a test case for us because, you know, the idea is, I mean, the backstory for him, if you're not familiar with him, is he runs a private security force, and we've actually had him appear in some of the news updates and stuff like that. He was on a, I can't remember if it was an opnet or the bounty hunter one.
I think it was Opnet.
But yeah, he basically was talking about like job opportunities and being a freelance operator and stuff like that. And so, but the fun thing with him was that he basically was going to offer. He sort of straddled the line of, you know, legal and illegal. So, he was sort of fun in the sense that like he would give out both missions, because again, we were doing a test case, so we were trying to figure out like what could kind of be the most sweeping. example. And so, but the fun thing about him was this idea that, like, you know, and obviously it's all a work in progress, but like understanding how reputation affects how you get these missions, like why they give these missions to you and stuff like that. And one of the cool things about him, he was hacking. You didn't need to shoot him in the back.
Could have waited until he finished hacking.
He was right in the middle of a job. Was this idea that like he's sort of a slippery character. Like we wanted him to feel like you could, you know, if I as a legitimate, you know, freelance mercenary who's looking for jobs and is not trying to go out and like do crime or kill people or whatever, or not people who don't deserve it. But you know, if I get a call from this guy, I want to be able to have a sort of a working relationship with him and not necessarily know whether he's doing anything shady or not. Like he can call, you know, call you up and be like, hey, I got an escort that needs a run, you know, that needs some protection. Can you, are you free? And then you can work for him, and you do the escort thing. It's a perfectly above the
board. Well, he's got to have his front business. He's got to have his totally. Legitimate face. So if you're living above the law, you could have quite a relationship with Phil Miller. I'm just going to call him Phil Miller from now on. Sure. Instead of Miles Eckhart. With Miles Eckhart, and you would never have an idea. No reason.
I mean, yeah, he's kind of a gruff guy and whatever. But like, yeah, you wouldn't think anything weird is going on. And yeah, it's that sort of fun thing that's like, I mean, has been sort of part of the DNA of it of Star Citizen ever since the creation was, Chris's insistence on the shades of gray morality thing rather than the black or white, the sort of notion that there were just criminals out there that are doing crime is an odd thing. Like, there are people who make a living doing that stuff, but you have a lot of legitimate people or people doing illegal things who have legitimate fronts, and and they're not necessarily all good or all evil, or like playing with that sort of idea was just a lot of fun and gives you a lot of opportunities to kind of create fun personalities and stuff like that.
So sticking just with the Eckhart character, because that's the one we don't want to spoil things for folks. Do you decide ahead of time we want to give him X number of missions for both sides? How does that process work?
It's a lot of conversation with design. We basically sit down, with Todd and Luke and Rob and work out what kind of missions we want this specific person to give. There's sort of a running list of kind of very broad scope mission styles. So, to break it down in a very simple way, like mercenary missions, cargo missions, type of thing. And within mercenary, you can have escort or, protection missions or rescue missions or whatever. So you have some sort of subcategories of it, but you go, all right, well, we need a mercenary mission giver in this system. And then you have lawful and unlawful and all that type of stuff. So usually it's a very kind of clinical conversation of like what need are they fulfilling? Mm-hmm. So we'll talk with them and figure out like what they're looking for as far as like what makes the most sense as far as gameplay and fun and all that type of thing, and just talk it out basically to the point where we can go, all right, well, we need somebody here who needs to handle these types of missions. And also it's actually important to mention, it's like looking at sort of the broad scope of the system itself. So in what will ultimately become Stanton system, we have all these different locations, and we have one person here and one person here and one person here, and this person is a lawful mercenary person. Do we need a unlawful mercenary person to counterbalance that? So there's like, so people have the gameplay that they're looking for. You got him.
I got him. That's Bernadette. He's good too.
So yeah, it's a lot of conversations of like exactly what's needed at the time, and then we sort of will start to flesh out the character. Oh, you bled out?
Nope, I got the grenade off before I died.
Yep!
I'll trade you one for three.
Did you see the two top there. Three on our team is? Is no. that JJ out here?
Yes, JJ.
Oh, hey, Tyler.
Hey.
JJ's running the board. So we've got Eckhart. He's got missions for good people. He's got missions for bad people, in its simplest sense.
Yeah.
Do any of those missions... do any of the missions exist in both cases, like the same kind of cargo mission but from a good perspective versus a
that's
bad perspective?
Definitely one of the things that it's an ongoing conversation about figuring out, because there's a very interesting thing of like, well, okay, if Eckhart hires you to protect, or a company hires you to protect something from going from point A to point B, would there be a pirate who would go, I want that stuff that's moving from point A to point B be taken? So it's I imagine a huge technical thing to try and work out. So it's, but we're trying to figure out that type of stuff. Like that's sort of one of the things is trying to figure out the extent in which we can kind of push the envelope on how these missions are generated and stuff like that.
So one of the questions we get quite often, I've seen it in chat already a few times now, Tessa Bannister.
Yes.
Tessa Bannister. What's the deal with Tess? Is she an AI? Right off the bat, go on the record right now. Is Tess an AI?
There are no AIs.
I don't believe you.
Well, there was the Artemis one, but the AIs go bad. That's our That's our line, and we're sticking to it.
So you're willing to go on the record right now that Tess Bannister?
No, she's a human. She's a real person. She's definitely a person.
Just trapped in a comma ray.
Yeah, she's just got a really boring job. But she seems to enjoy it, so, you know, good for her.
She was just dropped off forever. Yeah.
I mean, the thing I always kind of thought about with her was that sort of like the thing, you know, Kurt Russell playing chess against the computer. Like, she's stuck on this tour for like 8 months or a year.
Does she like souffles?
Undecided. it's a bold question, but yeah, I don't know. That's a
it's a bold question, Cotton. All right, so in the overall scope of Star Citizen, Tessa would probably be considered a pretty small, you know, part. I mean, she's just one essentially kind of random quest giver. But because of the way that we've been building the game out and whatnot, folks have had a lot of time
to hang out with
Tessa. Has this affected any future plans for, you know, for maybe her role in Star Citizen?
Well, I mean, it's nice to see that people like her. That's always fun to have that she really kind of in her very, because it's, you know, again, very one-sided interactions, and people seem to kind of enjoy her kind of weird quirkiness. So yeah, I mean, I think, you know, originally she was like you were saying, like she was just sort of a means to provide some kind of easy, cheap mission content. Because it was, again, it could be one-sided and could be very simple, and it was like for that level of the PU, it was a very scaled down thing, and we didn't have a lot of sort of tools at our disposal. Is that gun clipping? Why does that have two mags? Anyway, sorry. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting. It'll be interesting to see like how we can kind of fold her into, and characters like her into. The PU as it grows, because I mean it's a relatively cheap, you know, character in a sense, because there wasn't any kind of mocap for it. Was purely audio stuff. Yeah. But it's still, you know, it's a need, like to add more Tesla lines, you have to get an actor, you have to write the line, get an actor into a voiceover booth, you have to process the lines, you have to cut them up, you have to hook them up, you know, all that, implement them, all that stuff. So there's still a lot to it. So this, you know, it's one of those things. It's interesting to see like how we sort of scale it and stuff like that. So
will we have to redo any of her quests for 3.0 with the new mission system?
I'm not sure. I think so. I'm not sure. I don't know. It's one of those things that, again, you know, me and tech. I can use it. I can stare at it really nicely. But yeah, ask me about how anything works, and it's like. Magic.
Gotcha. So what else you got, Baron?
Oh, jeez.
Is it my turn?
Yep.
I was going to ask you a little bit about the flora and fauna. How involved are you guys with the creation of that process, and what that looks like really on that sort of lore perspective when you're trying to come up with a new entire animal or plant species?
It's thus far has been sort of a... We sort of will just kind of get sort of concepts, see like what artists are sort of working out and stuff like that, and then and try to make it work. Because again, it's we have so many different worlds ultimately that like kind of everything is useful. So if you go like if you say like, oh, okay, here's a bunch of rodents on Terra, and we're like, oh well, actually this might not work on Terra, you know. You could go, well, all right, then it goes on Vega or whatever, some other like naturally occurring place where it could go. So there's a lot of opportunities here, and all the stuff again it's super cool. I mean, one of the things that we're actually going to try and push forward with as the sort of more focus on kind of flora and fauna is we had had, I don't know if you guys remember, but we had had a bunch of several consultants go over our star map data and basically kind of pull it into the realm of reality,
as reality adjacent.
Yeah, like it was a lot of it could go very, because again, you know, asking me to do this stuff is a real this lunacy. But so they would take our stuff and they would go, all right, well, you can't do this at all, but you could do this, which would give you kind of a similar effect or stuff. And again, because our sort of initial thing was mostly about the character and the flavor and the tone of it, we had some flexibility as far as what the universe is for. But anyway, long story short, one of the things that we were talking about trying to do is just provide that information for the artist. So if it's for some reason helpful to know that it's this planet that they're going to be sketching out stuff for has got an M-class dwarf star at its center, so it'll get, and it's got this kind of gravity or whatever, like they can mm-hmm. incorporate that stuff into it if, you know, it's something that they can benefit from. But yeah, so hopefully we might get a little bit more scientific with it, but you know, it's all a work in process, so we're just trying to see what, but it's cool stuff.
Yeah. Let's see.
Sure. I've got a question. So every Tuesday you come out with, or your team comes out with another lore post in one of your many continuing series. Later down the line, do you have any idea how that might be portrayed in game? Will we see like in game lore posts?
You mean as far as like actually recounting events that are happening in game?
Yeah, just having all of the history and story, and that like a lot of them seem like radio shows and all that jazz.
Hopefully, yeah. I mean, it would be nice. Oh wow, well done. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, again, I think there's always been conversations about sort of in-game, like TV screen content.
Yeah,
and we already have like a lot of these things have been existing for a while and are characters that people kind of know. So we have a wealth of stuff that we can draw from. Again, I have a feeling a lot of it will just be sort of technical, feasibility
hurdles.
Yeah, because it's like, how quickly can we update this stuff and turn it around and stuff like that? Because as far as like larger scale universe stuff that the players might not necessarily have as much influence on, I think it'd probably be a bit more likely, like doing a news show that's like, oh hey Admiral, there was this attack on Vega 2, type thing that we could have playing for a while, or is of an event that we wouldn't necessarily, that we control, basically, mm-hmm. the release of. Seems like it would probably be much more feasible, but I mean, again, always the dream has been, and whether this is one of those things that just stays on, the Tuesday, it gets incorporated into the sort of Tuesday dispatches, is that thing of reacting to what players are doing in the game in a fun, dynamic way. So, seeing that, whatever, outlaw fight, devastating outlaw fight that took place in Nexus made the evening news, but all of the players in that are actual players would be sort of the dream, and would be just incredible to see, like, oh hey, that was me, my crew were the ones who shot up that poor truck stop.
Cool. Yeah, no, that's awesome. Yeah, I ask because every time I read those lore posts, it gets me like ready to jump in game and play. They're just so immersive, and I'd love to see some level of in-game integration someday.
Yeah, no, it'd be totally cool. Plus, just to hear some of those people live, out loud would be amazing.
Well, if you remember the Gamescom demo when they're coming in for landing, and he looks over at the screen in the Freelancer and sees the guy, like that'd be awesome if we had like news like that.
Yeah, definitely.
So some MMOs that I have played have had a concept of live events during gameplay. Well, certain things will happen on a large sort of time scale for players that will advance an in-game story plot. Does Star Citizen, not Squadron, but Star Citizen, are there any plans for things like that? And could that be challenging from a writing perspective, having to respond to what players do?
I don't know. I mean, it's again, one of those things that's very far down the line. I mean, it might be closer with 3.0 if that's something we want to explore. I'm not sure. I mean, I think ideally, yeah, you would want that type of thing, because I've done several of those with back in my World of Warcraft dark days, and being really excited by them and seeing it's like, it being really a fun way to feel like I'm part of that world. So I definitely think it's
I think there's a subtle difference between intentions and plans. It's definitely something we'd like to look into. It's definitely something we'd like to explore.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
I can tell you that, you know, just like the game is being developed, so are a lot of our tools and processes, including Game Master tools. And I can tell you that I've heard whisperings of that very topic being discussed.
I mean, it'll be interesting. But as far as to answer your second question, as far as like the challenges of that as a writing thing, I mean, yeah, it would be, you know, it's one of those bold things that when you do it, because you have to basically have, you know, result A and result B both ready to go once it happens. So it's a weird thing, because I think, you know, and understandably so, like, you know, you don't want to necessarily waste content. So you don't want to be doing these sort of crazy, epic, cool things and then just completely get rid of it and never be able to use it again because it's tied explicitly to this one event. But at the same time, like, yeah, it makes it feel... And again, like going back to sort of how Chris has always sort of described the universe, like not being static, that it's not sort of that World of Warcraft thing where it's sort of, it gets very locked in a place, and then it doesn't matter if you just joined up or you've been playing it for years, like it is what it is. I mean, they've obviously, with all their releases, have been updating that. Like, I haven't played it in a couple of expansions, but like, you know, obviously Wrath of the Lich King, like, really kind of blew up a lot of stuff, which was cool and made it feel like, oh, okay, it's going back to revisit it. So I don't know, but yeah, it would be a super challenging thing. I think it'd be fun. I mean, that sort of live reaction to the player's actions would be really fun and weird and exciting, and I think people would get really attached to it. So
oh yeah, just spawn a giant space whale outside Port Alizar.
Sure.
Yeah. Yep. We did that in the when we were just getting out of Friends and Family Alpha for World of Warcraft. We spawned Ragnaros in Stormwind.
I remember that.
I've seen videos of those days.
Victory.
I got to control Ragnaros for the Uther server.
That's awesome.
I was there for the blood virus.
the plague?
Yeah, the plague in Orgrimmar.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
All right. Alright, here's a question. Will there be choices in Squadron 42 that result in the death of wingmen or crew members?
I'm not going to comment on that.
I was going to say, yeah.
Yeah, that's kind of a spoilerific thing.
I have to wait and see.
It's a great question, but yeah. Sorry.
Sometimes I try, you know. I try not to.
It was a good attempt.
Yeah.
It was a great attempt.
Very solid attempt. Very solid.
Okay.
We need a group invite.
Will we have to learn about the customs of other species in order to avoid offending them?
I saw that one. That's a good one.
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah, that's a very tricky question. I think, because on one hand, I don't know. That's another thing that's in constant conversation. And we've actually, we have weekly calls with Britain, our xenolinguist, to talk about this kind of stuff, because again, like, as he's digging into language, he's asking us these questions of, like, you know, what are their cultures and stuff like that. I mean, I think for me personally, you know, I think it would be awesome to have the type of thing where you could your knowledge of their culture or their language gives you a slight perk, but it's not dismissive for other people. Like, that sort of thing where it's like, you know, if you say this to a Xion, they'll be super impressed because they're like, oh, clearly you respect my culture and, you know, I'll cut you a better deal, as opposed to you say it this way, which is wrong. But they're like, all right, you know, it's just a human, you know, type thing, and still sell me the thing. But they're like, you know, here's what it is.
Will there be multiple pronunciations of the word Xion?
Yeah, like that type of thing, like the Xion Sean, you know, thing, like, because it's. To me, again, this is me personally, like, I'm terrible at languages. I took 5 years of German in high school, and like, I could not speak it. But, so, like, I don't, like, the thought of having to, like, kind of learn a whole language just to be able to be functional in a game and not get penalized seems a little excessive to me.
That's what you're seeing.
But yeah, I think. But on the flip side, like, having that thing in there, where it's like, if you're cognizant of it and you're aware of it, that it gives you something kind of cool. Yeah. I think would be a nice reward for the people who are interested in that stuff and are really talented and skilled at kind of picking up that type of nuance and stuff like that. So, Long answer short, I don't know. It would be super cool though. But we'll have to kind of see.
Something to explore.
Yeah, definitely.
That's the awesome part about being in the development phase for these things. You're throwing paper wads at me?
Was that a Jared?
That was a Jared.
Was there a note on that wad I was supposed to read?
It said, I love you.
I doubt that.
Let's see.
You're right.
Yeah, he's opening it up. We're going to find out whether you actually love me or not. I know the truth.
I should write notes to you guys.
It's a grocery list. Okay. No, I'm kidding. This is nonsense.
Here's a question.
So he does not love you, I guess.
Nope. Ah! Will there be answers to Earth's myths, legends, and religions in Star Citizen?
You get answers?
Like, will there be a Bermuda Triangle?
Crystal skulls?
In Star Citizen? Oh. Yeah, will you solve the mystery of the crystal skulls in Star Citizen?
We'll solve aliens. One out. Zeus does not exist. There is no Zeus.
I thought you said Goose at first. Like you hated Top Gun.
Goose does not exist. Too soon.
I'll be honest. I was an Iron Eagle kid. Yeah.
Seriously. Were you as wrecked when you saw Iron Eagle 2 as I was?
I was. It was horrible.
But I'd never seen anything like it.
It's important to think back on that era and realize that the plot for Iron Eagle, which was a movie that got made with a budget, was about a bunch of kids, who one of whose dad got shot down, and they decided it would be a good idea to steal a fully loaded military jet.
Two,
that's right, because Luke Gossett Jr. went with them, and invade a country.
Yep.
Like, that was a movie.
It's about as 80s a movie as you can get.
It's pretty, yeah. And it's like those rascally high school kids who stole those Sidewinder missiles. It's pretty incredible. Yeah.
Yes. And then you get to Iron Eagle 2, and he's not court-martialed or in prison
or anything.
They
gave him a job.
They gave him a job. Although they didn't kill him 5 minutes into the movie.
Yeah, they're like, great job, kid. You stole from us good.
Yeah, spoilers. Iron Eagle 2.
Yeah. Although, to be fair, it's been this long since you've seen, and you haven't seen Iron Eagle 2, I think that boat sailed.
You need to examine your whole life choices.
Yeah, statute of limitations on that, I think, is passed. But, no, and I also hate geese. I got bitten by one as a child, so I have a long-time resentment against geese.
What?
Yeah, geese, man, they're mean.
After stream, you gotta tell us that story.
I was like four. I just remember like walking around a pond and walking up to this goose and thinking it was really cool, and then it just bit me. Forever.
Geese are mean.
They are mean. I'm telling you, they are.
So with you being an Iron Eagle guy and Chris being a Top Gun guy, does that ever lead to some interesting conversations?
No, I joke. I had the soundtrack to Top Gun, so obviously I enjoyed it on a certain level.
Well, yeah, it's Kenny Loggins. Well, yeah. Can't shake a stick at Kenny Loggins.
Kenny L.
Danger Zone.
Don't talk like you know him.
Right?
Oh, yeah, Kenny L.
No, I'm just saying. It's just that's
Kenny,
just,
nobody's ever referred to Kenny Loggins as Kenny L.
That's just, that's just affection right there.
Kenny Loggins.
We're officially off track now. Let's look for Chad. You got any more questions?
We could talk 80s movies all day long.
Let's see.
Hey, Jared.
Yes, sir.
Jared.
Yeah.
Jared.
What?
Oh, he's following you?
Danger zone.
Yeah. Llama. Oh, Reva got a belly full of laser.
I'm trying my best to keep my weapon working.
Yes, I do want to note that if we've lost a round, we've maybe lost one round the entire time we've been playing.
Yeah, you guys have been really doing well.
We're doing pretty good.
Who's been doing the best, though?
It's been rotating. There have been several rounds where I've been in charge. Actually, there have been several rounds where Baron has been in charge. There have been no rounds where Tyler was in charge.
JJ is just trying to
terminal.
Listen.
Sorry, what?
Go back to the terminal.
In charge of what?
Look at the sign above it on the right.
Tyler, choose Junkrat.
Okay, never mind. Cool.
Are you seriously QCing the game in the middle of happy hour?
Yeah. No, it's cool. It looks
what
cool.
Are we in charge of?
Nothing.
The sheep did.
The better question is, why is JJ have a mic?
He wanted me to have
one. You know, he's just going to try and stir stuff up between us.
It was a mistake. All right. Oh, here's an interesting question. What are some stereotypes that our various alien races have about humans?
Ooh, good question. Well, the Xi'an actually think that we're super emotional and impulsive. The Banu they just love us. They think they love everybody. They think everyone's pretty cool. Vandal love us too, actually. No, they
for different reasons. It's a different kind of lust.
They're totally ambivalent to us. But, I mean, the one that we've really worked out is the Xi'an one. It's been this sort of that's the one that we've actually kind of delved into a little bit, which is this idea that, like, they view us as, like, again, that sort of, because they live for so long that they're like, oh, these this cute little species who lives for 100 and whatever years. Whoops.
That looked great on my screen, though, Baron.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
It looked really good on my screen.
But yeah, that we're sort of, you know, reckless and impulsive and act more on instinct and emotion rather than intellect and more calculation. But yeah, the banner will probably be, I mean, that's actually be an interesting question. We should do a post-lunch conversation about that. That would be a fun one. But yeah, so that was a Tavarin. Probably depends on who you talk to. I'm sure there are some that...
They have some bad history with us.
They got some bad history, but they also they have a weird self-loathing thing. So there's like some of them who just like hate...
Oh, so I'm Tavarin?
Jared. But some of them probably still resent the, like, you know, horrible treatment that the UEE did. Some of them were like, you know, like Sush Kasi, who was, you know, recently passed a nice amendment on Tuesday, who's super supportive of, likes humans and thinks that, you know, the path forward is by uniting the two great cultures and stuff like that. So yeah, it's sort of they're sort of a bit more off all over the map, which again is sort of is fun to have that kind of variety, where it's more based off of character rather than. But the Bannon one, actually, you should look into that. That would be fun.
And what about the Kerthak? You thought I forgot about the Kerthak.
No comment. Well, actually, they don't know us. They've never met us. So
really?
Yeah.
I don't think I knew that.
Yeah. No, they. We found out about them, but, well, actually, it's unknown as to whether they know about us. But the
gotcha.
The Xi'an
are very. That makes more sense than I know.
Wow. Well done.
Jared, we lost. I'll give it to you.
No, we
I'll
lost,
give it
though.
To you. I know, but you know what? I'll give it to you. You did well.
I'm not going to give that to him. I think in a lack of opposition.
Let's see what else we got from chat here. Oh, is there more than one human language, or did we unify all language?
That is a good question. It's also a very technical one. We're trying to figure out.
Fair assault. Fair assault.
Well played. Because you have, again, it's one of those things. It's like realistically, there would be, you know, probably hundreds, if not thousands, of language within the UEE alone. Mm-hmm. But you know, as a game to deliver, you have localization that you have to consider. So there's like having a bunch of different languages staggered throughout it becomes, you know, it's difficult enough to just, you know, when you have all of your dialogue and text written in one thing, mm-hmm. in one language. So splitting it up where you go like, all right, well, these signs and text and dialogue need to be translated into this, but these are okay. And then, but the next set is these, and these need to be translated, but this one's okay. You know, like it's a bit more of a logistical thing to have to figure out. So, I mean, I think the plan was that there was a kind of a standard, you know, D&D terms, common tongue.
I successfully anticipated what that guy was doing, but it didn't help me. I still got killed. So, have you considered? Do you at that point, do you consider something like the Star Trek Universal Translator for people in UE if you have to explain it lore wise, or
you're
just not there yet?
Or the Babblefish? I don't know. That's a good question. I mean, I guess it's you know, it'll be one of those things that, like, once we kind of circle in on the localization thing of how that's going to be handled, mm-hmm. that we would, you know.
It's a bridge across when we get there.
Yeah, that we'll figure out a lore thing to. Oof.
You know what? I saw the grenade, and I thought, oh, that looks like a grenade on the ground, and I thought, but it's probably not.
It's a pretty safe bet to just toss grenades when you're heading towards B.
Yeah.
That's just usually a pro tip.
I got a question.
Yep.
So, Star Citizen has a lot of ground to cover in terms of, like, actual space, physical space. A lot of space to cover, rather. There you go. We got there. In games like let's say Fallout or World of Warcraft, there's quite often lots and lots of sort of little hidden jokes almost everywhere. If you look for them, you can find them, and they really help sort of make the environment. When you like in Fallout, if you've been questing for a long time and then you find a room full of plungers and you see someone has fallen from the plungers from the ceiling to the floor because they were trying to escape, that sort of stuff is kind of funny. Right. We saw the first one of those with the big mini Stonehenge. Is that sort of thing gonna be maybe more common in the full PU?
I think so. I mean, again, it's one of those things that, this is just for my personal taste. Like, I always, as far as like in references and kind of jokes go, like I'm a big fan of them and have done a bunch of them already. Just of kind of funny names and references, referential names and locations and stuff like that. Again, for me personally, it's always important that it doesn't come at the expense of the universe. If that makes sense, where it's like it's not taking me, like if I don't know the joke, it's going to take me out of the thing. But if I know the joke, I go, I get it. That's a very funny. Like there was one in they had a really clever Silence of the Lambs one in World of Warcraft. I can't remember where it was. Some undead thing where there was somebody named Clarice and something named Starling. That was very funny. But it was like, again, like if I didn't pick up on it, I could look at it and it would still make sense as this character, this sort of weird character, and I just kind of wouldn't understand what they were saying. So yeah, I mean, I assume so, because again, it's that stuff is a lot of fun, but yeah, for me it would just be about not, you know, not making it seem like we're making fun of our own universe, because that I think it starts to get into parody, and then it starts to get a little weird, and it's tougher to take it seriously when you're actively laughing at it. So it's always a weird balance.
Yeah, like all things, there's a balance. Yeah. My favorite thing along those lines that I've ever seen in my life was in Tenaris with the tire tracks that go into the mountain, and then on the other side of the mountain, the tire tracks that come out of the mountain. Nice. 'Cause I'm a Buckaroo Banzai guy. So it was a nice subtle thing.
Yeah.
If you didn't know it, it wouldn't mean anything to you.
Yeah, the other one that I always look to is I don't know if you've ever read any Farford and the Gray Mouser stories.
I actually don't know how to read.
Oh, okay. there's a great one called Lean Times in Lankmar. That's this Fritz Lieber's. I would highly recommend it. They're very fun. It's a very funny story, but it's not, and it's a fantasy. But it's like it's not. You know, I mean, I love Terry Pratchett stuff, but it can get a little goofy for me. But it's still, but it like as it what it is, it's great. But the Far From the Grey Mouse stuff is sort of weirdly light swords and sorcery stuff. So it always takes itself seriously as a universe, but you have the characters are so kind of extreme and quirky and weird that they can have funny stories and you still take the world seriously. So that's always been a sort of standout for me as something to kind of model after and aspire to.
Gotcha. So we are going to finish this game up. This game is probably going to wrap up right around the time, right around our closing time, so that's good. We are trying desperately to avoid a 4-cap right now.
Dave, I'd like to see the addition of a red planet. We could call it Red One.
Ooh. Is it too soon?
Hold on. No. Hold on. I'm just gonna do this.
Oh, he's gonna. I think he's gonna mess with you.
Don't take Tyler away from me. Do not take him away from me.
That's right.
Oh, he muted you.
Hey, Tyler, how you doing over there?
What's going on,
Tyler?
I'll bring you back, Doc. There you go. You're back online.
Tyler, talk to me.
No, I don't believe you.
Oh, thank God.
He turned him back on.
Okay.
Oh, I have no real power or authority here. Let's see. So this is our, what is it? No, we got one more round after this. So get your last minute questions in, guys. Dave Haddock, lead writer for Star Citizen and Squadron 42. Obviously, we want to avoid most questions about Squadron 42. It's important to protect the gameplay experience there.
Yeah.
What else we got going on here? Will there be planets with more primitive technologies?
Yes, technically those fall under the Fair Chance Act.
I was gonna say we have the Fair Chance Act.
So yeah, there are technically growing civilizations that are currently under the protection of the UEE to prevent people from uplifting them or messing with them or stuff like that. So, again, how that will actually play out, I'm not sure. But yeah, technically there are a handful of more primitive civilizations that are growing.
Well, like we saw one of them in the Constellation commercial. Not that the Constellation commercial was, yeah, it's a commercial within the universe.
Sure.
So it's not necessarily representing real life and stuff.
Well, technically it is in a fun way. If you look at the legalese at the end of it, it actually says that, like, do not do what these people did. It's highly illegal and highly unethical. So basically in a weird way, it's
let me do this here real quick.
No, what's going on?
No, we keep bouncing the mouse. So we get, every time we hit the table, we bounce the mouse and it brings up the little bar underneath.
Oh, gotcha. Baron. Sorry, that's my fault. But yeah, so technically in the Constellation commercial, it's acknowledging the fact that what these people are doing is super illegal.
Yeah.
So, but it's, you know, it's part of the selling the aspirational vision of the ship. So
that is right. It is completely truthful that Toast was the person who pointed that out to me the first time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, well done.
He was very amused by it at that point. At that point, he goes, look, there's legalese under there.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Toast, you nerd. So what is the, I'm going to reword this a little bit. Of all the systems that have been made public so far, what is the one you're looking forward to most being implemented in the game? Pick your favorite out of all your babies.
I'm very curious to see. Orion was a fun one, just because I like that aesthetic, like the look of that sort of shattered post-apocalyptic thing. And
this week's Lore Maker's Guide, guys.
That is
check
true.
It out.
Yeah.
Because also, yeah, it's just we'll get to be able to kind of tackle a lot of questions once we bring that area into sort of this development spotlight. So it'll be really interesting to see kind of how it develops from there. Because, you know, as far as the sketch goes, it was really fun. I mean, Cathcart would be the other fun one, just because, again, I'm curious to see how Spider manifests itself. Will be fun, but yeah, I would probably do. Do Orion or Caliban would be fun too.
Yep. Speaking of Orion, shout out to the Operation Pitchfork guys that are in chat.
Oh, hello. I still wear your guys' t-shirt. It's a great, not right now, but like.
I was going to say, did you change shirts?
No, it's at home, but it's in my daily rotation.
I mine's a sleep shirt actually.
Oh, nice.
So I don't wear it in public.
To comfort you.
It was just, the one I got was way too big, that's all.
Ah. Okay.
Do we have time for another one? Because there's a good one in here.
Yeah, we still got time. Magic isn't over yet.
Do you prefer writing dialogue for good guys or bad guys, and why?
Ooh. I'll go bad guys. Because I like, again, that sort of the shades of gray thing. I like it when bad guys aren't all bad. And it's also just, it's fun to kind of delve into, again, like their motivations behind it and why, and, you know, and stuff like that. So yeah, I would definitely, I mean, good guys are fun too, because then, you know, you go the opposite way and go, how to, you know, not make them white hat paladin types, and how do you make them fun and flawed and interesting and engaging. But yeah, you know, it's always something fun about writing the bad people. Jeez, sorry guys.
My back hurts right now.
KD ratio is a little negative there, my friend.
Yeah, wait. But I'm still number 2 points.
Mine's worse.
Yeah, I was gonna say. Yeah, but look at my score.
Oh,
You're done, good kid. Yeah, it's worth noting that it wasn't until I commented on how good we were doing that we started doing terribly. All right, guys. Well. That about wraps up our this latest edition of the Star Citizen Happy Hour. We went a little over the clock because we were all having so much fun. Thank you so much Mr. Dave Haddock, for taking the time out of your day.
Thank you.
I know you got lunch probably waiting for you at this point.
So. I think so.
So thank you for taking the time out of your day and chatting with us.
Of course. Thanks, everybody.
Bad News Baron, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to be here with us.
Indeed.
I understand you're going to stream Star Citizen at the close of this here.
Yeah.
Let's, Tyler, why don't you tell them which ship we're going to give them to raffle off today?
Oh, man. I have put zero thought into this at all.
You want to give these people a ship away?
You know what?
We're going to give you a ship to give away to your viewers over the next hour.
Don't give them things.
What are we going to give them, Tyler?
Let's just go with it's going to be a surprise so I can think about it. Because I don't want to just... I don't want to haphazardly throw one out. I want to put some thought into this.
All right, so you'll have to follow. You'll have to follow
Idris confirmed. No. All right, everybody, see me on my channel for an Idris.
So you'll have to follow Bad News Baron over to his channel. His channel's up there in the corner there, twitch.tv/badnewsbaron. You can check out his stream there immediately following the conclusion of this stream, and there will be a ship of some kind to give away as soon as Tyler.
Some kind.
Some kind decides. So,
you'll have to tune in to find out.
All right, so for Matt, for Tyler, for Dave, for me, for Phil Miller. We'll see you next week, everybody.
07.
I won't.
I'll miss you, Tyler.